Okay, good morning. So, inequality called as Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Now, Cauchy-Schwarz inequality states that if I am given an inner product space X and I take any two elements, say X and Y, that belong to X, then absolute value of inner product between X and Y is always less than or equal to So we proved this fundamental inequality, and I said that this was nothing but generalization of the result that mod of cos theta in three dimensions. We have this, we know this result, which we know from three dimensions. Cauchy-Schwarz inequality was a generalization of this particular results from three dimensions. In this particular case, X and Y are two vectors that belong to R3, are two vectors that belong to R3. And here, so when any two vectors X and Y that belongs to three dimensional vector space, we know this result, and this particular result is a generalization in any inner product space. Okay. Now, the reason why we wanted to work on this particular inequality was twofold. One was, well, we want to reach the concept of angle in a inner product space, in a general space, and at the same time we also want to prove triangle inequality in the inner product space. Why do I want to prove triangle inequality? I want to define a norm using inner product. Okay. I want to define the norm using inner product. So that's why I want to prove the triangle inequality. So how do I prove triangle inequality using this particular result? So let's move towards that. So this result is separate. This result is just for your reference. This three-dimensional result is only for your reference. So I am continuing again with our inner product space X. I am going to take any two vectors X and Y. So, and I want to find out inner product of X plus Y with itself. So this would be, if I just expand this, this would be X inner product X plus X inner product Y plus y inner product x plus y inner product y, right? Now, inner product, a number, it could be a positive number or a negative number. Inner product need not be positive always. Norm is positive. Inner product can be positive or negative. Cos theta, in this case, cos theta can be positive or negative. So, I am going to just replace this, I am going to replace this particular equality with an inequality. So this is less than or equal to, what is X inner product X? Always positive, not a problem. Okay. So X inner product X plus X inner product X plus 2 times absolute of X inner product Y plus y inner product y. You agree with me? Absolute value of this, this could be a positive or negative number. If this is a negative number, absolute value is always greater than this value. Okay. So I am just replacing this equality with this inequality. I have, fine. Even if these are complex numbers, still this particular inequality will hold. Okay. See, now I am going to use Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. This absolute value is less than X inner product X raised to half into Y inner product Y raised to half. Okay. I'm going to use this inequality here. So this will give me x plus y in a product is less than or equal to y in a product y raised to half. Okay? Is that fine? Just using Cauchy-Schell inequality, I get this. So this is less than or equal to actually this quantity is less than or equal to, I am continuing. This is a square now. You can see this is a square. Okay? But what is left hand side? So I can write that can I say this? All positive numbers, all are positive numbers. This is a positive number in a product of a vector with itself is a positive number. I can take a square root. Okay. I have expressed the right hand side as a square. So I can take a square root. What is this? This is triangle inequality. This is triangle inequality. If I define, see, if I define now, if I define a norm, okay, which is like this, then I have all three axioms satisfied. What is the first axiom? So we saw this. The first axiom is norm of x2 is greater than 0 if x is not equal to 0 vector and equal to 0 if and if and only if x is equal to 0 vector. Okay. Second, we saw what trivially held was alpha times x2 is equal to mod alpha norm x2. Alright. And what is the third? Triangle inequality, which now we have just now proved. Okay. So my third result is norm x plus y 2 is less than or equal to norm x 2 plus norm y. That is the result which I proved just now. Right? So inner product defines a norm. Very nice. Inner product, this norm is defined using an inner product. Induced by an inner product. So, can we draw now? Now that it is a norm, it's a length measure. Okay, can I extract something more out of Cauchy-Schwarz inequality? So, what was my Cauchy-Schwarz inequality? Let me see whether I can draw some more mileage out of Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. My Cauchy-Schwarz inequality was x y. Less than or equal to, right, which is nothing but norm x2 into norm y2. Everyone with me on this? Yeah. No. This is a positive number. This multiplication of these two positive numbers is greater than this positive number. So only you can use one way. So when you add a higher number on the right hand side, you get an inequality. If you wanted to use minus of something, then probably it's different, but there's only one way to use it. When you derive triangle inequality from Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, I don't see any other way you could use it. No, we are not assuming. I proved Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. I don't know whether you were present in yesterday's lecture. So we proved it. No assumptions. Quasi-Swartz inequality, we have proved by logical arguments. Okay? And now I am trying to see whether I can get some more insights through it. So, is this fine? Now we have defined a 2 norm. Okay. Now, what is a norm ultimately? It's a positive number. These two are positive numbers, right? Okay. I can take positive numbers inside absolute value. Not an issue, right? So, I won't be wrong if I say absolute of x fine. Is this okay? Just compare. I wanted to have x transpose y divided by 2 norm of x, 2 norm of y. Take 2 unit vectors in 3 dimensions, take inner product, what do you get? Cos theta. Okay? Take 2 vectors in 3 dimensions and take 2 unit vectors in 3 dimensions and their inner product will give you cos theta. Exactly, that's what I have arrived at in any inner product space, same inequality, no difference. Okay, so I am going to say now, well, let me define an angle. So now let me define an angle in any inner product space. Okay, how do I define an angle? So let me define 2 unit vectors, x divided by 2 norm. Okay, let me define another unit vector y cap, which is y divided by 2 norm of y, and then cos theta. Okay, or theta equal to cos inverse of inner product of x. Is it okay? Is this fine? So, inner product, generalization of concept of dot product to inner product allowed me to prove a very, very important result from 3 dimensions into any general inner product space. So, we could define angle between 2 vectors. Now, inner product space could be any set of objects, like we had set of continuous functions. Set of continuous functions over an interval. Okay. And when you study your undergraduate, you come across many such functions. They are called orthogonal functions. They are called orthogonal polynomials. Why are they called orthogonal? What is the basis? Okay. It's basically you are talking because there is an underlying inner product space, the inner product defined on it. And that inner product, okay, allows us to define concept of angle between 2 vectors. Vectors as in elements of the vector space, they could be continuous functions. That's why, you know, we have all those results when you look at Fourier series. See, if you take this inner product space, set of continuous functions over minus pi to pi, okay, then we are told when we study Fourier series that, and let me define an inner product here. Inner product is defined between any f and g, 2 functions, as integral minus pi to pi ft gt dt. Let me take this inner product space, okay, and let me define this particular inner product. Well, what we are told is that inner product of sin t cos t is 0 because they are orthogonal. Okay, when you hit upon this concept first time, that there are 2 functions, why are they orthogonal? In what sense? Because when you think of orthogonality, you are trained to think in terms of 3 dimensions, I, j, k, and so on. Okay, but what you should realize is that in the same sense, I, j, k, 3 unit vectors in 3 dimensions are orthogonal, these 2 vectors are orthogonal in that inner product space, set of continuous functions over minus pi to pi, or if you change to 0 to pi, to 0 to 2 pi. So this is interesting. So this allows us to talk about orthogonality of functions, orthogonality of general vectors in any vector space, any inner product space. So far so good. So we have defined angle. Obvious thing that comes next is orthogonality. Okay, we say that two vectors are orthogonal inner product is 0, simple. If the inner product is 0, then these two vectors x and y, any arbitrary vectors x and y for which inner product is 0 in the inner product space, they are orthogonal vectors. Okay. What are the other concepts that you need when you start orthogonality? Well, one thing we talk about is that a vector is perpendicular to a plane, right? We have to use a notion of a vector being perpendicular to a plane or a set. Let's say, so this, if I have this plane, okay, I can say that this particular vector is perpendicular to every vector in this plane, right? Every vector in this set. I could talk about an entire plane, I could talk about this limited set, and this particular vector will be perpendicular to all the vectors in this set. Okay. So if you have a subset S, which is subset of inner product space S, and a vector x that belongs to inner product space is such that x is perpendicular to y for any y that belongs to S, then we say that S is perpendicular, we say that x vector is perpendicular to S. If S is some subset of inner product space, okay, and I take any arbitrary vector x in the original space, this is a subset, this is a vector. If this vector is perpendicular to every vector that belong to the set, then the vector is perpendicular to the entire set. All these concepts will require more and more once we progress. Okay, so what result that I wanted to generalize, what was the best result in geometry that you keep using all the time? Pythagoras theorem. Okay, can we prove Pythagoras theorem? What is Pythagoras theorem? What is the statement of Pythagoras theorem? In three dimensions, let's look at three dimensions. What is the statement? How will you state Pythagoras theorem in three dimensions? If you are given any two vectors x and y, okay, I'm given any two vectors x and y in three dimensions, and let x be perpendicular to y. How will you state Pythagoras theorem? Norm of minus x, y plus x. X and y are two vectors. What will form a triangle? X plus y will form the triangle. Y minus x also can form a triangle. Both will hold. Then, so you want to say that can I say this is equal to x transpose x plus y transpose y? As he is rightly pointing out, this could be said even for x minus y. Okay? So x minus y transpose x minus y will also give you x transpose x plus. So this is my Pythagoras theorem. This is my Pythagoras theorem in three dimensions. Do you agree with me? Is anyone has a doubt here? What is x plus y? If I take two vectors in three dimensions, what is x plus y? Just try to visualize. Just try to visualize. Unless you visualize, you will not get it. let's say this is x vector and this is y vector. What is x plus y? This is my x vector. This is y vector. What is x plus y? Parallelogram law. In fact, now I would expect the parallelogram law to hold in, do you remember parallelogram law? Everything will hold. I mean, you are just generalizing. This is my x plus y vector, right? This is my x plus y vector and this is x minus y vector, okay? So now, if x and y are perpendicular, okay, then what we are saying is square of, so we are looking at a scenario where y is like this, sorry, x is like this, x and y, we are looking at a scenario where x and y are like this and x plus y is actually this, right? So square of length here is this square plus this square, that's all I am stating here. Okay, is this fine? So now all that I need to generalize this in an inner product space is to use the concept that if two vectors in the product space are orthogonal, then the inner product is 0. I just start with the same thing. So in an inner product space X, let X and Y belonging to X. Well, I am writing everything in this cryptic language because it's faster to write, otherwise, and you will get used to it after some time. X is perpendicular to Y, right? I pick up two elements X and Y in the inner product space which are perpendicular. All that I have to do to prove Pythagoras theorem is to start with X plus Y. This is equal to norm X, this is equal to X inner product X plus X inner product Y plus Y inner product X plus this is 0, this is 0, X and Y are perpendicular, inner product is 0, okay? What follows is the classic Pythagoras theorem generalized to any inner product space, a grand generalization of ideas, same ideas. What you should not forget is the ideas of geometry which we are using from your school, three-dimensional vector space which you are used to in your college, same thing is being generalized in different spaces, okay? So if your geometrical ideas in three dimensions are clear, you will understand what is happening here. You cannot visualize what exactly this means in a function space. Visualization is not so easy, or I don't know whether it's possible, or in n dimensions, or but geometrically it is the same thing. What is happening here when you have two perpendicular vectors and writing orthogonal Pythagoras theorem? Geometrically, it's not at all different. That is important to understand. Okay, same geometrical concepts are, we are not able to visualize this. Okay, so what next? How did orthogonal vectors help you in three dimensions? What were they used for? Can somebody throw a light? Standard basis, orthogonal basis, very, very useful, right? We use orthogonal basis all the time. So you had three unit vectors which are orthogonal. In fact, you chose them orthonormal. What is orthonormal? Unit vectors. Orthonormal, their magnitude was 1, okay? So orthonormal vectors helped us to define any arbitrary vector in terms of its components along certain directions, right? So we write a vector x component along I direction and y component along j direction. This is the first time when you start looking at coordinate geometry. This is how you start representing a vector, right? So we need now exactly the same thing. We need to generalize a set of orthonormal basis vectors in any inner product space, and then we should be able to express a given vector in terms of an orthogonal basis, right? Because orthogonal basis has many, many advantages in computations as compared to non-orthogonal basis. Okay. Okay, so in three dimensions, how many ways you can construct a basis? What is a basis in three dimensions? So, for example, yeah, three independent vectors. Okay. So in three dimensions, just like this, you know, this, let's say, k, this is unit vector here, say k, I and z. Just like these three unit vectors form a basis, okay, I can take some three other vectors say e1, e2, e3. As long as these three vectors are linearly independent, they can form a basis. There are infinite ways of defining a basis in three dimensions. Given that there are infinite ways of defining, so I can, if I give you some arbitrary vector in three dimensions, say this vector, so this vector v, okay, I can write vector v as v is equal to say x1 e1 plus x2 e2 plus x3 e3, where e1, e2, e3 are three basis vectors. I am perfectly allowed to do this. Okay, yet we prefer to work with, so same vector v, we find it convenient to write in terms of, you know, some component xi plus yj plus zk and so on. So we prefer this basis over this basis. Prefer this basis over this basis. Okay, so likewise, are there some special basis which are more useful when you do computations? It turns out that there are. Okay. Now, for example, I have a function, continuous function, which is a polynomial. Okay. Can I define an orthogonal basis for a set of polynomials? Then I can express, okay, I can express a polynomial something like this using orthogonal components. I can express a function using orthogonal components. I can express a function using orthogonal vector, orthogonal components along certain orthogonal polynomial directions. So I am going to generalize this idea. I don't like this when I work in three dimensions. I prefer this. So I need orthogonal basis when I go to an inner product space. So now I am generalizing a concept of orthogonal set. In this case, I, J and K is a set of orthogonal vectors. In fact, they are set of orthonormal vectors, right? A set of orthonormal vectors. So in the inner product space, if I give you a set, okay, and if I pick any two elements in that set, okay, and if the inner product of any two elements is 0, then that set is orthogonal set. When will we call it as orthonormal set? If each one of them is a unit vector, then it's a orthonormal set. So if each vector has unit magnitude, then we call this set as a orthonormal set. Okay. Now, moving on to, okay, so do you remember how do you construct, if I give you in three dimensions, if I give you three vectors which are not orthogonal, I want to construct an orthogonal set starting from a non-orthogonal set. How do you do it? Does, if I say Gram-Schmidt process, does it ring a bell? No? You don't know what is Gram-Schmidt process? Okay, we will study what is Gram-Schmidt process. So I like orthogonality because it helps me to represent vectors in a very nice way. And So if I am given a set which is not orthogonal, I would like to construct a set which is orthogonal. Okay? If I am given a set which is not orthogonal, then I can construct an orthogonal basis which helps me to represent vectors. Okay. So first I am going to start looking at three dimensions. We will generalize to set of polynomials. We will then go to function space and so on. So, okay. Let's go back to our three dimensional vector space. We have this vector V. We have this vector V here, and so let's call this x, y, and z directions, and this our ijk are three unit vectors. Okay. If I wanted to compute component of V along x, how do I do it? Dot product with unit vector in that direction, right? So, right, I use the unit vector V transpose I. So, this vector, this will give me inner product, dot product actually, we should not say V transpose, V dot I. That is the right, V dot I, not V transpose I, V dot I. So, dot product will give me x component. Okay, dot product of V with J will give me Y component, and dot product of, okay. So, suppose I find out, if I am given vector V, okay, I find out the component along X, okay. Let's call this vector as Vx. What is Vx? Vx is, you know, component along x. I am going to call it as Vx. Okay. So, what will be V minus Vx? What will be this vector V minus Vx? Yeah, it will be two components that are remaining along y end. So, everything that was along x has been removed. Okay. Now, what remains is only, okay. So, in fact, you would expect that component to lie in which plane? Yz plane, right? Okay. Now, this idea I am going to use to come up with this concept of Gram-Schmidt process, okay? Is this clear what I talked about just now, that you find a component along a particular direction, remove it from the original vector, what remains is along the remaining orthogonal components, okay? So, this is a very, very important concept. Well, Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization can be done only in an inner product space, not in any vector space, because inner product defines angle, orthogonality, and the things that you really need to construct an orthogonal basis. Okay? Idea of orthogonal basis cannot be thought of in some other arbitrary vector space where inner product is not defined. Okay? So, definition of inner product is crucial when it comes to. Okay. Now, let us start with R3. Let us start with R3. Okay. So, I am taking three vectors V1, V2, V3 which are linearly independent in R3 but not orthogonal. Okay. They are not orthogonal. They are just, okay. I am given three vectors in R3 and then I want to construct a set which is orthogonal basis, right? I could have constructed a basis from this which is a non-orthogonal basis. This basis would be, you know, one way of constructing a non-orthogonal basis will be V1 upon, right, and V2 upon norm V2 and V3 upon I can construct a unit vector. I can construct three unit vectors, but they are not orthogonal. Okay. So, I would like to go to orthogonal set from this. Okay, so let us define vector E1. Okay, this vector E1 I am going to define as V1 divided by 2 norm of V1. Is this fine? Okay. Now, I want to construct, this is unit vector, so I got one unit vector. I want 3 unit vectors which are orthogonal. In fact, I would like them to be orthonormal. Then what I am going to do is, I am going to remove the component. I am going to define a new vector z2. I am going to define a new vector z2, okay, which is v2 minus component of v2 along e1. How do I find component of v2 along e1? Dot product. Times, this is a scalar, right? This is the component, this is the scalar component along e1. So this vector minus this will be everything now that is left which is not along. So z2 will have everything that is not along e1. Is e1 perpendicular to z2? You can just check that z2 dot product e1, what is this? This is v2 dot product e1 minus v2 e1 e1 dot product e1, or e1 in a product e1. What is in a product e1? 1. So this is 1. So what do you get here? 0. Okay, so I have constructed a vector z2 which is orthogonal to, okay, so z2 is perpendicular to e1, but z2 is a vector which is not a unit vector. I like unit vectors, I, j, k. Okay, so how do I get a unit vector? I will take e2, which is z2 divided by norm z2. Okay, so I have two vectors. See, this z2 and e2 are aligned along the same direction, magnitudes are different, right? So e2 and e1 are also perpendicular. So e1 is perpendicular to, okay, is that fine? Now what next? I want to now construct a third vector, so v3. So I will construct a vector z3 which is v3 minus component along e1. You can very easily check that z3 is perpendicular to e1, z3 is perpendicular to e2. Not difficult to check. Okay, just take inner products, you will see that z3 is perpendicular to e1, z3 is perpendicular to e2. Okay, so e1, e2, e3 are mutually orthogonal. Okay, so how do I create e3 now? Take a unit vector along z3. Okay, so take a unit vector. Okay, so we started with a non-orthogonal set and we got an orthogonal set. We got an orthogonal set. I can do this. Why just in 3 dimensions? You have some doubt? Which one? See, this e3 is a third vector which I am going to define just by taking unit direction along z3. Okay, see, I started with, what did I start with? I start with V1, V2, V3. These are not orthogonal. Okay. So from V1 I constructed this E1 vector. Okay. Then I removed component along E1 from V2. Okay. Whatever was left was perpendicular to E1. Okay. Next, then I defined this Z2. I defined a unit vector along Z2. Okay. Then I removed component of V3 along E1, V3 along E2. Right? Whatever was left was perpendicular to both E1 and E2. You can just check this. See, because E1 and E2 are orthogonal, if you take inner product of this, inner product of E1 with E2 will be 0, and inner product of E2 with E2 will be 1. Okay, so it will just nicely follow. So you started with 3 non-orthogonal vectors. Finally, I got this Z3, which is not a unit magnitude vector. So I am just making this a unit magnitude vector here. Okay, so I can generalize this process in n dimensions. If you are given n vectors in n dimensions, okay, how could I construct an orthogonal set? In n dimensional space, how can I go on doing this Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization? So I could systematically go from 1, 2, 3, 4, you know, so this is E1 is X1, then Z2 equal to X2 minus inner product X2 E1 and E2 equal to and so on. I just go on methodically doing the same thing. Okay. Then E3, then E4, then E5, then E6. I can go up to EN. So starting from a non-orthogonal set. Okay. So what we'll see in the next class is we'll take an example in 3 dimensions, construct an orthogonal set. We'll take a set of polynomials which are not orthogonal, construct set of orthogonal polynomials. If you just follow Gram-Schmidt process, what will pop out is Legendre polynomials. Okay. I think you have heard this name, Legendre polynomials. And then you must have heard shifted Legendre polynomials, and they must have heard Bessel's polynomials. All these things will fall into line if you understand Gram-Schmidt process. Okay. It's some orthogonal set constructed on some inner product space of interest. Okay. And those sets can be constructed simply following the simple idea from 3 dimensions, Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization. Okay. That is the message. Okay. So next class we'll look at examples of this.